请问,
Let me ask you.
耶稣现在在哪里?
Where is Jesus right now? I believe that we all know that Jesus has risen. But let me ask you, is Jesus truly living within you? Let me ask you, who among you truly experienced the resurrected Jesus in your life? Not because you are a Christian. Many so-called Christians only know that Jesus has risen in their minds. But Jesus is not living in your life. This is not something that happened today. This is something that happened 2,000 years ago. And on the road to Emmaus, there were two disciples. They were disciples. But Jesus wasn't living within them. And that day when Jesus died, they lost hope. They gave up their own faith. They were going back to their hometown in Emmaus. But praise be to God. The resurrected Lord met them that day. And it changed their whole lives. Luke chapter 24, verses 13 to 35. Talked about the experience of the Emmaus resurrection experience. There are 23 verses of scripture here. And it was a journey. It was a journey from Jerusalem to Emmaus, and then from Emmaus back to Jerusalem. From Jerusalem to Emmaus, it was a 7-mile road.
So the
whole distance, it was around 14 kilometers.
It
wasn't a very long, wasn't very short journey either. But you've got to pay very close attention to this passage. Then you will discover something very special. These two disciples, from Emmaus to Jerusalem, they became completely different people. At the beginning, they started out with their eyes clouded. Look at verse 16. But they were kept from recognizing him. Not only that, their faces were downcast. Verse 17. They stood still, their faces downcast. And their footsteps were slow. Look, verse 28. The day was almost over when they arrived at Emmaus. They started the journey early in the morning, and then they arrived around 4 or 5 o'clock in the afternoon. Imagine it was only a 7-mile road. On the average, a person would be able to take 3 to 4 kilometers every hour. But they really walked too slowly because their emotions were very heavy. Their minds were ignorant. Jesus said to them, "How foolish you are and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken." Their hearts were cold. Look at verse
32.
They said that as Jesus explained the scriptures to them, their hearts were burning within them. In other words, at the beginning, their hearts were actually cold. But when Jesus started explaining the scriptures to them, their hearts started to warm up. But when they went back to Jerusalem, their eyes were bright. Their faces were joyful. Their footsteps were quick. Their minds were enlightened. And their hearts were burning. What happened? Why was there a complete transformation? Because along that road, they met the resurrected Lord. Church, our faith is not a faith of the head, but our faith is a faith of life. I know that you believe that Jesus has risen, but let me ask you, only an experience of the head, or is it a life experience? Many Christians, they believe, yes, but they don't have the experience. That is why our lives don't see any transformation. On Easter Sunday, as I was having my devotion with my children, I asked my three children, are you Christians yet?
Yes.
They said yes. I asked them, when did you become a Christian? Or when were you baptized? So all of them gave different dates. But I said to my children, our faith doesn't stop. But our faith is moving. 10 years ago, you became a Christian. 20 years, you became a Christian.
Very good.
Very good.
This
is the beginning of your faith. But then I asked my three children, and within those 20 years of being a Christian, or 15 years, or 10 years, has your life continued to change? And if your life hasn't changed at all, then I have serious doubts about your faith. Our Lord is a resurrected Lord. So our lives must continue to change. So may God help us. And on this Easter Sunday this year, through these two disciples, let us learn one thing. How can we experience this resurrected Lord changing your life? Do not only leave your faith in your head. Oh yes, I'm a Christian. I've been baptized.
Really?
Really? How much has your life changed? Is your life continuing to change? And if it stops, then there is a problem with your life. Look at these two disciples. Their eyes were almost blind, their eyes brightened. Look at verses 13 to 16. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. I want you to pay attention to this phrase, that same day. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. That same day, what day is it referring to? That same day was the same day when Jesus rose to life. These two disciples went back from Jerusalem back to Emmaus on that same day that Jesus rose to life again. Why? Because Jesus was already dead. And how can these two disciples recognize Jesus? The Bible doesn't clearly explain. But perhaps it was like this. Perhaps these two disciples went from their village in Emmaus to Jerusalem. They met Jesus. They heard Jesus preaching. They saw Jesus performing miracles. And they felt that Jesus is the Messiah that they've been waiting for. So they started following Jesus. Perhaps they followed Jesus for a year, 2 years, or maybe even 3 years. But 3 years ago, or rather 3 days ago, Jesus was crucified on the cross. Jesus died on the cross. And all the hopes of these two disciples were dashed. Messiah has been crucified. They've lost hope. And although that morning, the women came with the news saying that the tomb of Jesus was empty. And some even say that they've met some angels saying that Jesus has risen. But no one saw him. And these two disciples felt maybe the women were just too emotional. Maybe they were just too sorrowful. How can a dead person rise to life again? So with a very disappointed hearts, they left Jerusalem to go back to their hometown in Emmaus. Because their eyes were almost blind. Their eyes were clouded because their eyes of faith had not yet been opened. And after Jesus rose to life again, Jesus was completely transformed. Jesus had a glorious body.
Based on physical appearance,
and based on physical appearance, this wasn't Jesus at all. And so you needed to know to recognize Jesus by faith, by your eyes of faith. Something happened in the Bible. In John chapter 21, verse 12, when Jesus appeared to his disciples, the Bible says, none of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. You know what the meaning of this is? When they saw Jesus, who is he? Yet no one dared ask him the question. Because in their hearts, they knew that that was Jesus. But from the looks, it doesn't look like he's Jesus. But they knew in their hearts that this must be Jesus. And that is a new recognition. When we meet Jesus, we don't see him with our own fleshly eyes. But we will understand, we will be able to comprehend him only from our hearts. If you have a loved one who have already died, and he or she is a believer, in the future, in heaven, you won't be able to recognize him or her, your loved one, based on the person's outward looks.
Outward appearance.
Because God has already changed the outward appearance of your loved one. Now, how can I tell that he or she is my loved one? You will know. It's not based on our fleshly eyes. But it is a spiritual revelation with the spiritual eyes. It will be exactly the same as the situation between these two disciples and Jesus. Jesus walked with these two men. They didn't know that this was Jesus. Because their eyes of faith have not yet been opened. Until something happened. And so they knew for certainty that this is the Lord. What happened? It was during the communion. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. While Jesus had a communion with these two disciples, when Jesus took up the bread, They said, "You are Jesus."
How can they know?
How can they know?
Because
when Jesus raised his hands,
these
two disciples saw something. What was that thing? The wounds on the hands of Jesus. You know, in heaven, there is not going to be anything that's man-made except only for one. And that is, those are the wounds on the hands of Jesus. If you look at Revelation chapter
5,
when John saw Jesus in heaven, suddenly he said, the lamb that has been wounded, the wounds of Jesus will still be there in heaven. Every time when you see the wounds, you will recognize that this is your Savior.
On the other side,
Isaiah chapter 49 verse 16.
上帝说,
God said,
看,
see, I have engraved you on the palms of my
什么意思呢?
Hands. What is the meaning of this?
耶稣看到他的手的时候,
when Jesus saw his hands,
就是看到伤痕,
when they saw the wounds on Jesus' hands, and it was the wounds of the cross.
每次耶稣看到这个伤痕,
and every time Jesus would see the wounds,
耶稣就纪念你,
Jesus remembers you.
耶稣就纪念我,
Jesus remembers me.
上帝将咱刻在你的手里面,
God has engraved us on the palms of his hands.
永远永远不会记得咱,
he will not forget us.
守圣餐,
having communion,
是代表咱头上帝听,
means to say that we are compelled by God's love. And that is why Paul says, for Christ's love compels us. Your eyes of faith needs to be open. Unless your love for the Lord increases. All his life, Paul served the Lord. Because in his heart, he saw the invisible Lord.
请问,
let me ask you,
你听主吗?
Do you love the Lord?
你好,好求主帮助你?
And may the Lord help you.
你需要增加听主的心?
That you need to increase your love for the Lord.
你拉听他,
the more that you love him,
你就拉看到他,
the more that you will be able to see him. The more that you walk away from him, the more that you will be unable to see him. So may God help you. That your eyes will be open.
Number two.
From being downcast, their faces filled with joy. Look at verse 17. Jesus asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. When Jesus saw the two disciples, their faces were so much downcast. So Jesus asked them, "What happened?"
He
says, "Don't you know?
3 days ago,
our hope, our Savior, was crucified. We have no hope anymore. And although some say that he has risen, that they've met an angel, but that isn't true. No one can prove that. Jesus is no longer in our midst." Many times, we have such kind of a thinking. If I see Jesus with my own eyes, if I hear with my own ears Jesus preaching, if I see with my own eyes Jesus performing miracles, then I will not leave the Lord all my life. Isn't that true? We think that way. I wish that I would have seen Jesus. That is not true. That's not true. These two disciples followed Jesus for 2 to 3 years. They've heard Jesus preach. They saw Jesus performing miracles. But when difficulties come, when crises arise, their faith was gone. You don't fool yourself. When problems come, it is a very important test of our faith.
You get it?
Remember, circumstances don't change you. Circumstances only reveal who you truly are. So you don't complain about your circumstances.
No.
Saying it was my father wasn't good, my mother wasn't good. I married the wrong wife, such a difficult person. I married the wrong husband.
No.
Doesn't change you. Only reveals what kind of person you are. When difficulties come, how do you face it? And how you're going to face it reveals where your faith is. Psalm 42 verse 5, an interesting verse. Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise Him, my Savior and my God.
Because
why are you downcast, O my soul?
And
he's saying that, God, may you help me with your face of smile.
应当仰望上帝,
for I will yet
put your hope.
I will put my hope in God.
你说第43章的国家, the same.
And on Psalm 43, verse 5, the same. Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise Him, my Savior and my God. When difficulties come, when a crisis arises, you have two choices.
Number one, put your hope in God.
Put your hope in God. Put your hope in Jesus. Or focus your attention on your difficulty. Here lies our problem. When difficulties come, we don't look to God. Rather, we focus on the problem. And as a result, the problem gets magnified. Many years ago, when I was still in Hong Kong, there was a fellowship that invited me to preach. And the leader first spoke to me. I was a pastor, Pastor Cheung. Please come to my fellowship to preach. But I want to let you know that I've got a big problem with my fellowship right now. Originally, we had more than 40 people. Something happened. Now there are only like three to four of us meeting. So I'd like you to please come and to our fellowship to encourage us, to challenge us. 40 people becoming 3 to 4 people. I really don't know what to preach on. So I prayed. I said, God, what do you want me to say? How can I encourage them? But praise God. Suddenly, God gave me a prompting. Isaiah chapter 5, verse 30 suddenly came up. And if one looks at the land, there is only darkness and distress. Even the sun will be darkened by the clouds. And with this verse, I preach on a message with them. What are you going to be looking to? If you're going to look to the land, you are going to only see darkness, difficulties. Because your head is facing down.
Look up.
You've got to look up.
You've
got to look up and look to the sun, to the God behind the clouds. And so with that message, I encourage them.
After 2 years,
I had the opportunity to go back to that same fellowship to preach. I myself had forgotten that I preach on this verse. But that person spoke to me. Says, Pastor, thank you. That day, the message that you preached was a great encouragement to our fellowship. So that from 4 people, they increased to more than 10 people, 20 people, And when I went back to preach that day, there were more than 30 people again. Church, may God help us. Is your face filled with sorrow or joy? You know, there are some people who are very strange. When they wake up in the morning, no one quarreled with them. But their face is really like downcast. Do you have such kind of people in your home? I have one in our home. My eldest daughter, she's always smiling. She wakes up in the morning. She smiles.
Hi, Papa. Good morning.
Hi, Papa. Good morning.
Say.
So I will be very happy. But one of them, you don't have to guess which among them. When he or she wakes up, he doesn't smile.
He or she,
So people are strange creatures. No one quarreled with the person. But he or she just doesn't feel good. So I just thought, well, it actually came from me. It's from my genes inherited from me. When I was little, I was like that. I don't know why, but I would wake up and I'm not happy. But praise be to God. After I became a Christian, my life really changed. When I wake up,
every morning,
I would be very happy. So it's for me, it's a new day, new opportunity for me to serve the Lord. Because God helps us with His smile. May God help us. When they met the resurrected Lord, you shouldn't be sorrowful anymore. We should be joyful. Or what about you? Have you met the Lord yet?
Number three.
Their footsteps from slow, it turned into running strides. From Jerusalem to Emmaus was only 7 miles. For an ordinary person, an average person would be able to walk 2 to 3 miles an hour. So you would be able to finish that the journey in 2 or more hours.
But that day,
they started walking in the morning up until 4 to 5 o'clock in the afternoon. Why such a long time? Think about that. Because their hearts didn't feel good. When I was a young boy, my father used to tell me, just when we walk, we've got to take our step, got to lift up our hands and feet and walking. We shouldn't be dragging our feet. Some people walk this way. They take one step, and then they drag the other feet, the other foot. They're dragging their feet. Not only are they slow, they're not energetic at all. You never see a soldier walking like that. You see a soldier walking like that? That's not the way a soldier walks. But why was this person walking this way? There is a very important example in the Bible. Then you will understand. There is a person by the name of Elijah. Elijah is the most the greatest prophet in the Old Testament.
And the most powerful.
The most powerful. With one person alone, he faced 400 false prophets. Up on Mount Carmel, he competed with them. Says, who would be able to call fire down from heaven? His God is a true God. And so Elijah prayed. And God sent fire down from heaven. And so the Israelites shouted, the Lord, He is God, the Lord He is God.
Elijah 有这个命令,
and Elijah gave a command to kill all the 400 false prophets of Baal. And that was supposed to be a great revival. But when the news reached the rich Queen Jezebel, Jezebel was very wicked. She gave a command. Tomorrow, at this time tomorrow, I want Elijah killed.
Oh,
the Bible says, Elijah saw the situation and fled at Kadesh Barnea. He sat down under a broom tree and prayed that he might die. Arthur saw God came along, gave him food, gave him drink, and allowed him to sleep, and then gave him food to eat again, and allowed him to sleep, and then he got up. And God said to him, from Kadesh Barnea, where you are right now, I want you to go to Mount Horeb to meet with me. You know how long it takes for that journey from Kadesh Barnea to Mount Horeb? 11 days.
Deuteronomy chapter 1 verse 2.
Deuteronomy chapter 1 verse 2.
圣经讲对何勒所
takes 11 days to go from Horeb to Kadesh Barnea by the Mount Seir Road. But do you know how long it took Elijah? It took him 40 days.
1 Kings 19 verse 8.
Elijah traveled 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Horeb.
11 days.
He should have arrived in 11 days, but it took him 40 days. How did he walk? You understand now? During the time, Elijah was depressed. His heart was very heavy. He didn't have any energy at all. He was walking, he was falling, he got up again, and then he walked, and then he fell again, and on. It took him 40 days. So this is our experience. If you are emotionally unwell, and if you are powerless within you, no matter what you do, you feel like you don't have the energy. Do you have anybody in your home that just wants to lie on their bed and don't want to get up? Do you have any? Just lying on their bed. Get up. And he said, no. He doesn't want to get up. Not that he's tired. There are some people who don't want to get up to work. They don't want to get up to face difficulty. It is really like that. My father used to be like that. Before my father became a Christian, his life wasn't good. He liked to gamble. And so I discovered something. There is one day that he's lying on the bed and he doesn't want to get up. 8 o'clock. 9 o'clock. 10 o'clock. And he still doesn't want to get up. I know. Last night, he lost. And so he doesn't want to get up. But if he wakes up very early that morning, you know that he probably won some money last night. Very strange. People's emotions affect your action. And it's exactly the same with these two disciples. They were emotionally very low. They were very depressed. And so they don't want to do anything. They don't want to do anything at all. And they are very slow in doing everything. So people are different when they're energetic or not. But after they met the resurrected Lord, they immediately changed.
Look
at verse 33. They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together. So it was like late in the afternoon, almost evening, but they got up and they returned and they got to Jerusalem at once. And then the disciples were still meeting there. They were still assembled there. So it took them like maybe a couple of hours. I believe that they probably didn't walk, but they ran. Habakkuk chapter 3 verse 19 is a very good explanation. The sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer. He enables me to tread on the heights. The Lord is my strength. He makes my feet so fast, like the feet of a deer. And he helps me to be able to walk in a very stable manner. And if you meet your resurrected Lord, and if His power is within you, let me tell you, your whole being will be totally different. The way you work, the way you do things will be completely different. Feet represents our work. Let me ask you, do you like to go to office on Mondays? It is said, Many people like to commit suicide on Mondays because they don't like to work.
And you go, thank God it's Friday.
And so you say, thank God it's Friday.
Na Monday le?
What about if it's Monday?
Mulang thank God.
Nobody thank God for that.
Because if Monday go chui gang, wah go pai mi ah pai mi ah.
Because I feel Monday it's a day of work again.
No.
No.
你问我系出嚟啦，你问我系见啦。
You ask the people in my family. You ask my children.
Every day.
For me, I'm so excited about every day. One time, my children told me,
Pa,
we start work at 9 o'clock, not 6 o'clock. Is it okay if you don't wake up that early? Why do you have to be in office that early? No, I go to the office and then I read my Bible, I pray. I start work at 9 o'clock.
Could you bang Chinese?
May God help you. If there is power, there is strength in your heart, then you will not see Monday as a very frightening day.
This is an opportunity.
This is an opportunity. May God help us.
Number four.
From ignorance, their minds became enlightened. Look at verses 25 to 27. He said to them, how foolish you are and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. Such a pity though. What a pity that these two disciples did not record what Jesus spoke to them about. Jesus explained to them from the Old Testament scriptures that the Christ has to suffer. Beginning from Moses and throughout all the prophets, everything pertains to Jesus. Look at Hebrews chapter 10 verse 1. The law is only a shadow of the things that are coming, not the realities themselves. What is the meaning of this verse? The Old Testament is the shadow of Christ. The New Testament is the substance or the reality of Christ.
Old Testament is about the shadow of Christ.
It's only about the shadow of the Christ. The New Testament, Jesus came. And if you don't understand this,
example.
Let me give you an example.
For example,
you're not married yet. Lawrence is not married yet. We want to introduce somebody to you. So how do you introduce the person?
So,
let me show you a picture. This is a beautiful woman.
Oh, beautiful.
You say, oh, she's beautiful. But just pay attention. Be careful. There's people do a lot of Photoshop these days. Perhaps she's not
okay,
really that beautiful. So take a look at this picture.
Beautiful.
You say, wow, she's beautiful.
Whoa, I like this girl.
I like this girl. You say, yes.
Yes.
But
she's
in the U.S. right now.
After 6 months, okay?
She'll be back after 6 months. Are you going to wait for her?
Of course.
Of course.
很水耶.
So beautiful.
好啦, 你 every day,
so every day,
看这个相,
you look at the picture,
哪瓜哪水,
and the more you look at the picture, the more beautiful
哪瓜哪水,
she becomes. The more beautiful
哇,
she looks to you.
某话都是个,
sometimes you even can't hold
stand it
that you wanted to kiss a picture.
阿米,
she's really so beautiful. When you sleep at night,
帮你枕头鼻头,
you put it right beside your pillow.
6 months都是这样的,
so you do that for 6 months.
这是shadow, right?
This is just a shadow. Just a picture.
好啦, after 6 months,
so after 6 months,
这个路来咯,
the woman comes home. She came home from the U.S. and she came to see you.
你说, hi.
You say, she says, hi.
Hi, Lawrence.
Hi, Lawrence.
啊,怎么着,没差,没差,没差。
And then you're ignoring her.
我看这个熊, 没看, 没看。
I want to look at this picture.
关着你的目睛,我继续看这个。
Your eyes is fixed. You're glued to that picture.
这个,真的人来咯。
The real person is here.
擦洗啊,擦洗啊。
And you say, yeah, hey, don't bother me.
看这个。
I look at this.
啊,你有警察不?
Is there a problem with you?
有警察的不是?
Is there a problem?
Yes.
Many people have a problem. We read the Bible. We read the Bible not for the sake of reading the Bible, but to be able to know the Christ of the Bible. You've got to read the Bible to the point that you are able to see the Lord and meet the Lord. Jesus rebuked the Jews for something. You study the scriptures diligently because you think that in them you have eternal life. These are the very scriptures that testify about me, yet you refuse to come to me to have life.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes,
the scriptures testify to me. Scriptures contain eternal life. But I'm already here. And still you don't want to come to me, and you still want to find me in the scriptures. May God help us. Let us not read the Bible in that kind of a manner. Paul says, the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. When you read the Bible, you've got to read to the point that you are able to see the Spirit. May God open our spiritual eyes. May God open our minds. Let us not be too legalistic. Many times, we do not know, we don't get to know the Lord because we are too legalistic. And the Bible tells us that the all these sums up, love is all the summation of love. All the laws. If without love, you are a legalist. Many times, parents and their children very often have this problem. You ask every parent, do you love your children?
Of course.
Of course I do. Well, who would not love their own children? But don't be too happy yet. But then you ask your child, do you feel the love of your parents? He or she might say no. Parents say, yes, I do. And the parent says, no, no, you don't. So who's lying? Neither of them are lying. Parents love their children. But then the children don't feel the love of the parents. And here lies the problem. There is a gap. Some Sometimes we as parents don't understand that we discipline them in order because we love them.
你需要让你的孩子明白, discipline because of love.
You need to let your children understand that I discipline you because I love you.
但是呢,
but many times we have such kind of a problem. Because we are too much of a legalist. Our hearts are too ignorant. Our hearts aren't open. We aren't able to see, we aren't able to understand the things that we need to understand. And so Jesus said to the two men, you who are ignorant, you've been reading the Bible for so long, and you still don't understand what the Bible says. And so Jesus explained the scriptures to them. And as a result, they suddenly came to an understanding. May God help us. You must read the Bible with your heart. Not as simple as just reading it with your minds. Fifth. Their hearts from being cold began to burn. Look at verse 32. They asked each other, were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us? Isn't it that when he explained the scriptures to us, our hearts were burning? We see therefore that it used to be cold. Why would a person's heart be cold? A person's heart will be cold because of unbelief. If your heart is without faith, then your heart will be, if you are without faith, then your heart will be cold. Genesis chapter 45 records something. The son of Jacob said to him, Joseph is still alive. He's still in Egypt and he's the prime minister. And what does the Bible say? Jacob was stunned, or his heart was cold, because he did not believe them. Jacob did not have faith in his children. His children were lied a lot. You're lying again. And you reported to me that Joseph was killed by wild animals. And now you're telling me that he's a prime minister in Egypt. Jacob couldn't believe his children until when he saw the carts Joseph had sent to carry him back, the spirit of their father Jacob revived. If people don't believe you, first, you must examine yourself. Why is it that people don't believe my words? Because you probably are a liar. And you've lied too much. And people have lost their trust in you. But what about us? If God speaks to us, would we believe him? May God help us. Let us believe God's word with faith. God's not going to lie to us. These two disciples, because of God's word, their cold hearts started burning. Because God's word is true and he will never ever lie to us. But let me ask you, how much of God's word do you believe? Do you believe God's word 100% or just 50%? Our hearts are not zealous enough. Because we always discount God's word. We don't believe God's word. Is that true? Is that possible? May God help us. You need to believe 100% of whatever God says to you. Then your hearts will start to burn.
The word of God is active.
Because the Bible tells us that the word of God is active. It's alive. God's word is not dead. And it's going to change your life. Take a look at these two disciples. Originally, their eyes were clouded almost to the point of getting blind. Now their eyes became bright. Originally, they were very downcast. Their faces are now filled with joy. Used to be that they walked very slowly, but they started walking so fast. Used to be that they were very ignorant, but their minds now understand. Their heart used to be very cold, but now it began to burn. There's only one reason. They met the resurrected Lord. And so their own lives became resurrected as well. Some people said, many Christians are lacking in 7 inches.
You know why?
It's the distance between the head and the heart. It's 7 inches. Many Christians, the fox remain here, but they never get transported to here. So they lack 7 inches. No wonder our lives never change. May God help us. Let us not be lacking anymore. Let it come in here and be transported to our hearts. And then from our hearts to our hands, then your life is going to change. May God help you. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. These two disciples allow us to learn something very important. Not just listening to Jesus preach. Not even seeing Jesus perform miracles. But we will believe all our life. When difficulties come. When tribulations come. Our faith are shaken. Unless the resurrected Lord is within us. Unless we have experienced the resurrected Lord. Then our lives will be changed. Lord, we don't want our eyes to go blind. We want spiritual eyes to be able to see spiritual things. Lord, we don't want our faces to be sorrowful. But we want our faces to be joyful as we face this world. Lord, we don't want our footsteps to be very slow. We want to take the path of the Lord and we want to do God's work. Lord, we don't want our minds to be ignorant. We want to have an enlightened mind to think about God. God, we don't want our hearts to be cold, but rather we want a heart that is burning in order to serve the Lord. May the resurrected Lord meet with us again. Just like how he met the two disciples to change our lives. Our salvation is not a salvation that stops.
Move on.
But we need to continue to move on so that our lives may continue to change until we become like Christ. We know that with your power that is within us, we will be able to do this. Help us. Thank you, Lord. This is our prayer in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.